I am very happy to speak at the birthday conference for Kyiv Algebra Department. This is a department of my close friends. This is the department where I feel great, and I cherish all connections to this department. I will talk about finitely presented algebras. My talk will contain many open questions. Everybody knows that the best talk is a talk that contains a question that you can answer. I hope that my talk will be a good talk for somebody. Okay, let F be a field and let A be an algebra over the field F. Let A be a finitely generated algebra, so it is generated by elements A1, A2, and so on, An. Let F of X be the free algebra on N generators. Then there exists a surjective homomorphism from this free algebra onto the algebra A. And let I be the kernel of this surjective homomorphism. I intentionally did not specify if A is an associative algebra or a Lie algebra. Let us say that A is some algebra and F of X is an appropriate free algebra. Later I will be more precise. If the ideal I is generated by elements R1, R2, and so on, Rm as an ideal, then we say that the algebra A is presented by generators X1, X2, so on, Xn, and relations R1, R2, Rm. Generators and relations completely determine the algebra A. The algebra A could be a very infinite dimensional algebra over an infinite field, and still, if we have finitely many relations, then we encoded it in finitely many phrases, which is interesting. In this case, we say that the algebra A is finitely present. My talk will consist of two parts. In the first part, we will address the question, which algebras are finitely presented? And in the second part, we will address the question, suppose that we know that an algebra is finitely presented. What does it give to us? Okay, the first part. Let us start with associative algebras. Recall that two algebras with an identity element are said to be Maritain equivalent if the categories of their left modules are equivalent. A property is Marita invariant if any two Marita equivalent algebras either both have it or both do not have it. Montgomery and Small proved that finite generation is a Marita invariant property. Recently, Al-Ahmadi and Al-Sulami proved that being finitely presented is also a Marita invariant property. As far as I know, this paper has not appeared yet. Another important family of infinite dimensional algebras. I will talk only about infinite dimensional algebras because finite dimensional algebras are obviously finitely present. Let us start with associative algebras and groups. So R is an associative algebra. We consider the algebra of n by n matrices over R. A matrix that has an element A at the intersection of I's row and J's column and zeros everywhere else is called a matrix unit. If I is not equal to J, then this matrix unit is a nilpotent matrix, and therefore this sum with the identity matrix is invertible. This sum is called a transvection. The group generated by all transvections is called elementary matrix group. It's an important group. It would be very nice to present this group by generators and relations, but it is very difficult. Therefore, Robert Steinberg went different way. Let X sub ij of A be symbols that correspond to transvections. And let us consider the most obvious relations that are satisfied by all transactions, and we consider a group presented by these generators and these relations. This group is called Steinberg group. Of course, there is a surjective homomorphism from the Steinberg group to the elementary matrix group. As far as I know, it is still an open problem if the kernel of this surjection always lies in the center. The expected answer is no. Though positive answer is known for various interesting cases, like when R is a commutative algebra. The question, when is the Steinberg group finitely presented? Of course, we should assume that the ring R is finitely presented. Raymond Soule and Krstic and McCool answered this question. If R is finitely presented, then the Steinberg group is finitely presented for n greater or equal than 5, but this is not necessarily the case when n is equal to 3 or 4. Now let us consider Lie algebras. Let us consider the Lie algebra generated by all matrix units. Let symbols xij of A correspond to these matrix units, and let us consider the most obvious relations satisfied by these matrix units. The Steinberg Lie algebra is presented by these generators and these relations. It was introduced in the 80s by Spencer Bloch and Kessel Lodey. In this case, it is easy to see that the kernel of this surjective homomorphism always lies in the center. So this is a central extension. In general, for a perfect Lie algebra L, a central extension is an epimorphism from another perfect Lie algebra L prime, such that the kernel lies in the center. Among all central extensions, there exists a universal one, such that all other central extensions are, well, homomorphic images of this universal central extension. Let us denote this universal central extension by hat. So this is the universal central extension of the elementary matrix Lie algebra. Since the Steinberg Lie algebra is central extension, we have this diagram. Kassel and Lodey proved that for n greater or equal than 5, the Steinberg Lie algebra is universal. It is the universal central extension. Actually, they claimed it also for n equal to 3 and 4 without any proof, but this is not correct. Gao and Sheng completely determined this kernel for n equal to 3 and 4, and it is not always zero. The kernel of the homomorphism from the universal central extension is the so-called cyclic homology group of the algebra R. In particular, it does not depend on N. And that was the motivation for Spencer Bloch and for Kessel Lodey to study this Lie algebra. They wanted to compute this homology group. Our problem that we consider now is, when is this universal central extension finitely presented? Well, under the assumption that the algebra R is finitely presented. In a joint work with Zhezhou Zhang, we proved that for n greater or equal than 3, this is always the case. For n equal to 2, even for the free associative algebra, this is not the case, as shown by Zhang, and his proof is based on our joint result with Ivan Shostakov on finite presentability of Jordan algebras. Now I want to ask two questions. Suppose that R is a finitely presented ring. Is the universal central extension of the elementary group finitely presented? You know, we know when the Steinberg group is finitely presented, but since the expected answer that the homomorphism from the Steinberg group to the elementary matrix group is not central, this is a very different group. And it is known that the Steinberg group is not finitely presented for n equal to 3 or 4, but this is a very different group. It still may be finitely presented. And another question. Elementary matrix Lie algebras and Steinberg Lie algebras are a particular case of root graded Lie algebras. There is a theory of root graded Lie algebras. There are many families of root graded Lie algebras. So what about other families? When are they finitely presented? Let's consider other important classes of infinite dimensional Lie algebras. Of course, Katz-Moody algebras are very important, and they are finitely presented by Serre-Katz theory. Now let's consider Lie algebras of Cartan type. The first of them is the Lie algebra W of n. It is the algebra of derivations of polynomials and n variables. And it has other Cartan type subalgebras, special, Hamiltonian, and contact. It's a long story, and there are many papers on their finite presentability. It all probably started with the work by Jan Stewart. In the super case, the super analogs of this Cartan type algebras contain a very interesting class of superconformal algebras. So Stewart, Fagin, Fuchs, Leiters, Politaeva, and others proved finite presentability of these Lie algebras, and Leiters in 84 proved finite presentability of Virasoro algebras, superconformal algebras of Navier-Schwarz and Ramon. My conjecture is that all known superconformal algebras are finitely presented. Another important class of infinite dimensional Lie algebras. I will introduce the definition of Poisson brackets and Poisson algebra that was introduced by Vladimir Bavula a little bit earlier today. Let A be an associative commutative algebra. A bilinear bracket is called the Poisson bracket if it satisfies the following identities. First, it defines the structure of a Lie algebra on A. And second is product rule. Example, the classical Poisson bracket of Hamilton that underlies classical mechanics. A generalization of it. A bracket is called contact if it again defines the structure of Lie algebra on A, and if you fix one variable and let it be the identity element, then you get derivation with respect to the other variable. If it were a Poisson bracket, then it would be just zero. And in a contact bracket, it is a derivation. And the second is an extension of the product rule. Question. Find sufficient conditions for the Lie algebra of Poisson or contact bracket to be one, finitely generated. Even when A is a polynomial algebra, it is not always finitely generated. And second, if it is finitely generated, then find conditions for it to be finitely presented. It might be difficult. But this sufficient condition should be meaningful, because superconformal algebras can be obtained via contact bracket. So this sufficient condition should cover superconformal algebras. Okay, now, step part. Suppose that we know that our algebra is finitely presented. What can we say about it? What does it give to us? I will start with a famous problem, maybe the most famous of the remaining Burnside problems. The original Burnside problem asks if a finitely generated torsion group is finite. There are numerous counterexamples due to Golot, Novikov, Adyan, amazing examples due to Olshansky and others. Now, is there an infinite, finitely generated torsion group that is finitely presented? It is still not known. Tangentially, this question was touched in the Today talk of Alexander Olshansky. Kurash formulated an analog of Burnside problem for algebras. Recall that an associative algebra is said to be nil if an arbitrary element is nilpotent. Suppose that you have a finitely generated nil algebra. Is it always finite dimensional and nilpotent? The answer is no. Golot example is a counterexample. And for many years, it was the only counterexample to Kurash problem. Relatively recently, new examples were constructed by Lenagan and Smoktunovich. Now, let us consider even more narrow class, graded algebras. Do there exist infinite dimensional, nil, finitely presented graded algebras? It's not known. If they do exist, then Bekelin showed that there are examples that are quadratic, that are presented by quadratic relations. This is a very well studied class. About 15 years ago, Belov and Ivanov-Pogodaev announced the existence of an infinite, finitely presented nil semigroup, but the text hasn't appeared yet, hasn't been published yet. Now, suppose that you have an algebra, finitely presented, just in the same way as it happened in group theory. This is only the beginning. Then we can ask further questions. For example, the word problem. Given an element of the free algebra, can you say if it is equal to zero in the algebra A or not? Equivalently, if you have a finitely generated ideal such that A is a factor algebra of the free algebra modulo, that ideal and you have an element in the free algebra, is there an algorithm that would allow you to decide if that element lies in the ideal or not? In general, the answer is no. There are examples such that there is no such algorithm. Algebras with undecidable word problem. But even if the word problem is decidable, so for an arbitrary element, you can decide if it is equal to zero or not. Now I will be slightly imprecise. What does it mean, decide? You start with an element and you start doing reductions. You do reductions, reductions, and finally you reduce it to zero. Then this element lies in the ideal. And you want to know how many reductions did you have to make to prove that this element lies in the ideal. So what is the computer time complexity of this of the word problem? It is easy to define the degree of the element, say the length of the maximal length of the monomial involved in this element, and we consider all elements in the ideal of degree less or equal than k. For each of them, we determine complexity and take maximum of these complexities. It is called Dehn function. It measures time complexity of the word problem. And a word problem is decidable if and only if this Dehn function is recursive. More precisely, for associative algebras, an element F lies in the ideal I generated by the set R, if and only if it can be presented as a sum of this type. Of course, the presentation is not unique. And we take a presentation with minimal number of summands. We say that this number of summands is computational complexity of the element F, time complexity. For all elements of the ideal of degree less or equals nk, we take maximum of these complexities and we have got den function for associative algebras. This den function is geometrically sound. If you choose another presentation of the algebra A and both presentations are finite, then their den functions are asymptotically equivalent. So they have the same type of growth. Now an open problem. I formulated this problem maybe 15 years ago. I mentioned it many times in emails to many people, but I never published it. And since this talk will be on YouTube, it's almost a publication. So I'm very happy to have this talk on the YouTube. For a problem, suppose that you have a finite subset of the free associative algebra and you have a fixed number m. Is the following property decidable? The property that an element A can be represented as this sum with m fixed number of summands. If you don't fix the number of summands, then it's not maybe not decidable. But if you fix the number of summands, I believe that it is decidable, though it is open. If the answer is yes, then an algebra has decidable word problem if and only if its then function is recursive. Now, suppose that the then function is recursive, word problem is decidable, and even then function is not too big, say quadratic. It still does not tell you how to decide. It's not deterministic. There are various ad hoc algorithms for different algebras. The only generic, universal deterministic algorithm that I know, so the deterministic algorithm to decide what problem is an algorithm that is known by many, many names. It is attributed to Buchberger, logicians attributed to Church-Rosser. It's called Groebner basis algorithm. People in algebraic geometry attributed to Hironaka, in computer science to Knut Bendix. It's known as Newman lemma. There are very good reasons to attribute it to Shershov. It's called diamond lemma, composition diamond lemma. If something is known by so many names, it must be important. So what is this algorithm? First, we order all monomials. Usually we order them by length-lex order. So first you compare lengths, then you do it lexicographically. But there are examples of more exotic orderings. So you order monomials and in each relation, you choose a monomial summand of which is maximal and move all other monomials to the right-hand side. So since the relation is equal to zero in the algebra A, this maximal monomial is equal to a linear combination of smaller monomials in the algebra A. So we have got a rewriting system. Rewriting system, you have an element, whenever you have a word and you identify it as a subword, which is a leading monomial in some relation, you reduce it. You reduce. But you can apply, you know, a word can contain several subwords of this type. So you can apply different reductions. And it would be nice to identify a class where the result, the normal form, does not depend on which reductions you apply. It is done in the celebrated Newman lemma. Newman lemma says that if any two reductions of the same element have a common descendant, then the final result does not depend on the order in which reductions were made. We call such rewriting systems terminating confluent system. Terminating means that there are no cycles, and in infinitely many steps, you arrive at a normal form. And confluent means that the assumptions of Newman lemma hold, so it does not matter which reductions you choose, which way you go. Suppose that you have a finite Grobner-Chershov basis, which produces a terminating confluent system, very good reduction system. What does it give to us? Well, it tells us that the Dehn function is no more than exponential, because you reduce, you never increase the length of the rod. So the so-called memory complexity, it's a maximal length of a rod that is needed, that appear in these reductions, is linear. And since the number of different rods of in a given alphabet of length n is exponential, the complexity function is no more than exponential. Mark Sapir communicated to me some very, very nice defining relations, semigroups with relations. These relations are just permutational, and they produce interesting Dehn functions. You can get exponential Dehn function or even this Dehn function. Okay, Newman lemma. In Newman lemma, the result does not depend on which way you go, but the complexity very much depends. So for a, let's look at this example. Very simple example. Dehn function is linear, but if you are stupid, if you go the longest way, it could be quadratic. So let's consider semigroups now, presented by these relations. So we can talk about algebras, but let's consider semigroups. And for a rod W sub zero is a normal form. And this is the shortest way to reduce it. And this is the longest way. So we could have two complexity functions. This is if you always choose the worst solution. And this is Dehn function. We call a rewriting system uniformly confluent if these two functions are asymptotically equivalent. So basically it does not matter which way you go. Roughly speaking, you always spend the same number, the same amount of time. It is difficult to find Dehn function for rewriting systems and for groups and semigroups. There are very deep and interesting works by Alshansky, Sapir, Rips, Berger on Dehn function in groups. Now I will mention some very simple sufficient condition that allows to that guarantees uniform confluence and allows actually to compute Dehn function. It's very restrictive, but it's applicable to many important cases. Suppose that we somehow managed to assign to every rod a non-negative real number. We call this number area of this rod. So to each rod, we assign its area. There are reasons to call it that way. In such a way that whenever you do reduction, the area goes down, but not by much, not more than by epsilon. In this way, our reduction system is confluent, and actually the complexity is asymptotically equivalent to this difference between the area of W and the area of its normal form. Example. That also appears in many cases. Suppose that you have a square matrix of non-negative real numbers. Given a rod, for every pair of letters, we consider the corresponding entry of the matrix and we sum all these entries and we declare it the area of this rod. If in our defining relations, these words always have the same composition. Same composition means that every letter occurs in both words the same number of times. Then we only need to be sure that in defining relations, the area goes down. Example of this matrix area function, the commutative, free commutative semigroup. This matrix would provide us with area function. Another example, much more interesting and much more complicated. The Knut relation, not Knut relations, actually some system of finite relations in a plectic monoid. Plectic monoid is quite prominent in combinatorics. And now another feature of this matrix area function. It provides us with uniformly confluent system, but it gives us much more. You know, then function is a complexity function of the worst case, because we take maximum of complexities over all words, but it does not necessarily have to be the worst case. Let Bn be the set of all words of length up to n, it's a finite set, and then we consider the average Den function, so the average complexity. If you have a matrix area function, then the average complexity is asymptotically equivalent to the Den function, that is to the worst case complexity. It is counterintuitive because average complexity, average Den function have been studied in groups. They were introduced by Gromov. And in free abelian groups, the average Den function is smaller than Den function, which is intuitive. Because if buses live with an interval of 20 minutes and you come to a bus stop, you should not necessarily expect to wait 20 minutes. Maybe you will wait 10 minutes. But it's only because groups are semigroups and with cancellations. For every generator, you can cancel it with its inverse. So I'm trying to say that the average function is smaller, average complexity is smaller than the worst case complexity only because of these cancellations. Now two problems. Does there exist a semigroup or a group or an algebra with a finite Grobner-Cherchov basis such that the Den function of the reduction system that corresponds to this basis is smaller than, it's a misprint, is bigger, strictly bigger than the complexity of the semigroup, group, algebra R. If you find such an example, that will define some limits for the method. So you can find the finite Grobner-Cherchov basis, but it does not give you the best complexity. So you cannot get the best complexity in this way, in principle. And the second problem, does there exist a semigroup with all, where all this left-hand side and right-hand side of defining relations have the same composition, so no cancellations, such that the average complexity is strictly smaller than the worst case complexity. If, in simple words, is it always true that average complexity is smaller only because of cancellations? Okay, the mathematical part of my talk is over. Now I will use the privilege of the last speaker to congratulate the organizers on a wonderful conference. I have never participated in such conferences. You know, I'm slightly older than your department, and I participated in many conferences, never in a similar one. You took a high risk to organize this conference, and you won. In many countries, there are military medals that are called Brave Hearts. You deserve these medals. Thank you.